Hey guys, this is Neal Davis from Digital Cloud Training. This video is another exam question reviewer where I'm going to walk you through some practice questions from the AWS Certified Developer Associate Exam. So let's get on with it. First question asks, a decoupled application is using an SQS queue. The processing layer that's retrieving messages from the queue is not able to keep up with the number of messages being placed in the queue. What's the first step the developer should take to increase the number of messages the application receives? Okay, so we have a decoupled application using SQS, and we're finding that the processing layer that's retrieving the messages is not able to keep up with the messages that are being placed in the queue. So how can we change this so that the processing layer is able to keep up with the volume of work that's coming in? So let's have a look at the answers, and we're going to work from the top to the bottom. So what about using the API to update the wait time seconds parameter to a value other than zero? Now, this is actually associated with short polling and long polling. The wait time seconds is the amount of time that you're going to wait for a message to appear in the queue. So for instance, when a processing layer is actually trying to retrieve a message from a queue, how long does it actually wait until it finds a message, or does it just return an immediate response? With short polling, it returns an immediate response, so that means the value would be at zero. You can have the value up to 30 seconds, and that would be long polling. With long polling, the processing layer is actually keeping that thread open to the queue. It's waiting to see for 30 seconds, are any messages coming in the queue? And then when they do, it will return those messages. So you have to adjust that based on how long you want to wait, and there's some optimizations you can make there in terms of the amount of API requests you make, which can save money. In this case, it's not really going to help, because that's not the problem. The problem isn't how long they're waiting. The problem is that the processing layer just can't keep up with the amount of messages. So that's going to eliminate the top one. It's also going to eliminate the bottom one, because that's using short polling. So it doesn't matter here whether you're using long or short polling, it's not going to resolve this problem. The next one down is to add an additional SQS queue and have the application poll those queues. Well, yes, you can absolutely do that. It's a way that you can scale SQS horizontally by adding additional queues. But in this case, that's not really going to help. And it's certainly not going to be the first way that you're going to try and resolve this. I think the next answer is better, because it says use the receive message API to retrieve up to 10 messages at a time. So that means that you're making fewer API calls, or you're getting more messages for the number of API calls that you actually make. So I like that answer the best, because that's the first step that you'd want to take in order to try and resolve this issue. Try and retrieve more messages in one go. That means you're making a more efficient use of the API calls. So let's check that answer. And that's the correct one. And there's just a bit of an explanation there letting you know why. So let's carry on to the next one. A developer is planning to use a Lambda function to process incoming requests from an ALB. How can this be achieved? So you've got an ALB, and you want that ALB to be distributing connections to a Lambda function. So how would you set that up? So let's start from the top this time. Would you create a target group and register the Lambda function using the AWS command line interface? Well, yeah, that sounds like the right answer to me. So straight away, we've got to the right one here, I believe, at this stage. So I'm going to say create a target group and register the Lambda function using the AWS CLI, because that is absolutely something you can do. You can create a target group, register the Lambda function, and then the ALB will distribute connections to that Lambda function. Now, why would you do that? Because it's not like you're load balancing across multiple Lambda functions. There can be some advantages here in terms of having a certificate on the ALB, and also things like being able to perform some application layer inspection. So let's move on and just check out the other answers. We want to make sure we can eliminate them for sure. So would you create an ASG and register the Lambda function in the launch config? Well, you can't register a Lambda function in a launch configuration. ASGs will launch and terminate EC2 instances. They don't create Lambda functions. What about setting up an API in front of the ALB and using API gateway and use an integration request to map the request to the Lambda function? Sounds a bit confusing. It's like you've got API gateway and then you've got an ALB, which is then routing to a Lambda function. Doesn't make a lot of sense. Doesn't look like a good answer at all. Lastly, configure an event source mapping between the ALB and the Lambda function. You can't create an event source mapping between a Lambda function and ALB, but you can register Lambda into a target group. So I'm sticking with that one. Let's just check that answer. That's good. So let's move on to the next question. A DynamoDB table is being used to store session information for users of an online game. A developer has noticed that the table size has increased considerably and much of the data is not required after a gaming session is completed. So what's the most cost-effective way to reduce the size of the table? So we've got users connecting to some kind of online game, and as they do so, there's some session information that's getting stored in DynamoDB in a table. And then once they finish their game, we don't need it anymore. So what can we do to optimize the size of the table and save some cost? So let's work down from the top again. Use the batch write item API to delete the data. Now, at least a couple of these answers are going to be costly. So one of the things you've got to think of with DynamoDB is that you're paying for the reads and the writes. So anything that's going to read or write is going to consume read capacity units and write capacity units. So we've got to be careful not to waste money using RCUs and WCUs. Using the batch write item API will be a way that you can actually go find the data and then delete it, but it's going to cost you some money. So not the most cost-effective approach. Next, create a Lambda function that purges stale items from the table daily. Well, again, this one is also going to need to read from the table and then delete the items. So again, it's using RCUs and WCUs. And we can see that the very last answer here is the same thing. It's deleting an item using an API call. So again, you've got to find the data and then delete it. It's going to cost you. Now, if you enable a time to live on the table and add a timestamp attribute on new items, that's going to purge that data automatically and it doesn't cost you anything. It just means that each attribute has a time to live, and after that time to live, it's going to be purged. So I like that answer. Let's choose that one. And that looks good. So let's just move down. You can see here a screenshot of where you enable a TTL. Let's move on now to another question. A team of developers are building a continuous integration and delivery pipeline using developer tools. Which services should they use for running tests against source code and installing compiled code on their AWS resources? Now we're looking for two answers here, and it looks like we're looking for one answer, which is going to be how do we run tests against our source code, and one, how do we install the compile code on the resources? So in other words, how do we deploy that code? So let's have a look through these, and we're going to look for those two particular requirements. Firstly, we've got code build for running tests against source code. Well, that sounds about right. That's what code build does. It helps us to be able to perform a series of tests, and then if our tests pass, then we can move on to the next stage in a pipeline. So let's choose that option. I like that one. And let's check out the next. We then got code deploy for installing the compiled code on the AWS resources. Well, code deploy, absolutely. It is a deployment tool that you can put into the pipeline. So after you've gone through code build, you've tested, everything looks good. Now you might want to deploy it, and you could use code deploy for that. Now, do you use code pipeline for running tests against the source code? No, code pipeline is the continuous integration, continuous delivery pipeline that these would be a part of. So you'd have code build and code deploy, but the pipeline is automating the whole process, moving from one stage to the next stage. So that's not the right answer. Code commit for installing compiled code on resources. Code commit is essentially a Git repository on AWS. So you commit code to it, but it doesn't deploy code to your resources. And Cloud9 is an integrated development environment, so it's definitely not going to be the right answer here. So I like those two answers. Let's check those out. All looks good there. And here's a image of, or here's a diagram of a code pipeline. So here you have developers pushing code to code commit, the build servers, and then build and test the code using code build. The results are returned to the developer. And then once you're happy, you can then release the code for deployment using code deploy. So that's how a pipeline looks. Let's click on next. An application will be hosted on the AWS cloud. Developers will be using an agile software development methodology with regular updates deployed through a continuous integration and delivery model. Which service can assist the developers with automating the build, test, and deploy phases of the release process every time there's a code change? Well, after the last question, that should be a fairly simple answer. We've just talked about code pipeline and how code pipeline works, so I'm going straight for that one. Let's check out the others. Remember, code build is purely for testing. So it's not the entire CI/CD pipeline. CloudFormation, well, that's not going to respond to these changes whenever there's a code change. You have to go in and create a change set with CloudFormation. And with Elastic Beanstalk, similarly, you have to update your environment when you have some new code. So code pipeline looks like the best answer here. Let's check this out. And that looks good. So then let's move on to another question. A developer wants to debug an application by searching and filtering log data. The application logs are stored in CloudWatch logs, and the developer creates a new metric filter to count exceptions in the application logs, but no results are returned. What's the reason? So we've got application logs being delivered to CloudWatch logs, a new metric filter is being created, and we need to go in and actually read some information from those metrics, actually find some of the data that we're generating. So let's work through these and see what's going on here, because for some reason the filtered results are not being returned. Could it be that a setup of the Amazon CloudWatch interface VPC endpoint is required for filtering CloudWatch logs in the VPC? Nope, that's not what you need to do here. You don't need to create a VPC endpoint to be able to find data through a filter in CloudWatch logs. CloudWatch logs only publishes metric data for events that happen after the filter is created. Well, that sounds quite sensible and feasible, and in fact, that is true. So I like that answer. I think that's the best answer so far. Let's check out the last two, just to be sure. The log group for CloudWatch logs should be first streamed to the Elasticsearch service before filtering returns the results. Well, no, you don't need Elasticsearch to be able to get the results. You can go straight into CloudWatch logs after you've created a filter and start returning some results from that filter, but it's just going to be the new data from that point forward. Lastly, metric data points to logs groups can be filtered only after they're exported to an S3 bucket. That's not true. You can do it natively in CloudWatch logs. So I like this answer. Let's check that one out. That looks good. So let's scroll down and I'm going to move on to the last question of this set. The development team is working on an API that will be served from API Gateway. The API will serve three environments. We've got prod, we've got dev, and we've got test, and requires a cache size of 250 gig. What's the most cost-efficient deployment strategy? So let's just scroll through these first and look at each one and try and work out what is the gist of the answers here. What are they trying to find in terms of cost efficiencies? Well, we notice straight away that we've got two different styles of beginning here. We've got create a single API gateway, or we've got create three API gateways. So that's the first thing to consider. Do we want to create multiple API gateways? Sounds a bit more complex having multiple, but let's carry on reading just to be sure. Next, we've got stages and deployments. And so we've got to think about how many stages do we want and how many deployments do we want. Now, we know that the cache is deployed to a stage. And we can see that we're then talking about the cache and, you know, where we're going to enable the cache. Now, you do pay for a cache, so that's going to be the expense that we're referring to here. So what we want to do is make sure that we're reducing the amount of money we're spending on the cache. Now, as I said, the cache is deployed to a stage. So I'm going towards the second answer here because it says the single API gateway has three stages, but we just enable the cache on dev and test when we need it. So that's going to be a way of saving some money. So let's just select that and we want to check out the others. So I eliminated that one before because I don't like using three API gateways, but let's just read all of it. One for each environment and enable the cache for dev and test only when required. So it's similar to this one, but we're creating three API gateways rather than three stages, and I like three stages better. Create a single API gateway with three stages and enable the cache for all environments. That's going to cost more money, so that's not going to be the most cost efficient. That's what we're looking for again here. And lastly, create a single API gateway with three deployments and a global cache of 250 gig. Well, you create your caches at a stage level. You can't create them globally. So this looks like the best answer. So we'll just check that one out. Sure enough, that is the correct answer. And we've got a nice explanation here to help us. That's it for this walkthrough of practice questions for the AWS Certified Developer Associate Exam. I hope you found this useful. Please like the video if you did, and I wish you all the best in your exam.